tax accounting standards. There, I've said it. That's what we're discussing this week. Yes, I know it's Diwali and all. You're in no mood to listen to a tax discussion or an accounting discussion. Worse still, a tax and accounting discussion. Yet I suggest you listen closely because these tax accounting standards are going to have a material impact on your company's profitability. And while we can't cover all 14 standards in detail due to the lack of time, we are going to focus on the genesis of tax accounting standards, or TAS as we're referring to them, the deviations from accounting standards, and the implications on business. Well, to do that, I'm joined by Jameel Khatri of KPMG, Paritosh Basu of SR, and Vishal Shah of PwC. Gentlemen, to all three of you, happy Diwali and a warm welcome.
Thank you, Manika.
Jameel, let's start with you first. You were on the committee that drafted these draft tax accounting standards. Very quickly, in simple terms and 30 seconds, explain to me the genesis of these TAS and what they intend to achieve.
Yeah. So I think the background to this is that when India was trying to implement IFRS, one of the things that stopped us from moving forward was there was no certainty from a taxation perspective.
Right.
And the Ministry of Corporate Affairs then lobbed it at the Ministry of Finance to say, hey, how do we move into IFRS and still kind of have some sensible approach on taxation? So this committee was set up to look at that particular issue and advise on how the tax computation could be done in a post-IFRS regime. But as we moved forward, the question really was that could we use this as an opportunity to come up with something which would provide a framework for computation of taxes and along the way deal with the uncertainty that is there on computation and areas which are being litigated between the department and between companies.
All right, so before we judge these tasks on those two counts, which is reduce litigation and increase certainty, let's look at what material impact they will have on companies and their balance sheets. I think three or four sectors have been spoken of already in the media. And I want to start with you first, Vishal. Where do you see the maximum impact because these tasks deviate from accounting standards?
Historically, the tax provisions are contained in the income tax law.
Right.
So there are specific provisions dealing with specific items in the income tax law. The accounting is relevant only to the extent those set of provisions are not dealt with in the income tax law.
Right.
So, you know, typically these areas are in terms of forex accounting, the ones which is sort of commonly debated is on the mark to market related adjustments that happens.
Right.
The recognition of the revenue, the law does not specify as to how do you go about recognizing the revenue, and therefore you go back to your accounting, and some of the deviations proposed by the committee and the report is relating to recognition of revenues, particularly for services companies.
Right.
That has an impact, and also in respect of construction contracts leading to realty companies and the EPC contractors, etc., which could have a potential impact in terms of how do they recognize their revenue.
Let's go with Forex first then. What impact do you think this task will have on the way you were accounting for Forex transactions?
The Forex deviations from the normal accounting standards, as I look at it, and I read, and Jamil can probably expand on that, is limited to the effect where the exchange difference arises on items which are not forming part of your balance sheet as on that date.
Okay.
So only in respect of the monetary items like, say, debtors, creditors, receivables, etc., that sort of exist on the balance sheet date, the task continues to say that you will compute them as on the last date of the balance sheet based on the exchange rate as on the date of that balance sheet. Where the TAS deviates from the current practices is where they say that where people have entered into foreign exchange derivative contracts, which is what the hedging would typically policy of the companies would be, to get into sort of hedging contracts for enter into foreign exchange derivatives.
Right.
When the foreign exchange derivatives is in relation to items which are probable in terms of your probable sales or your probable imports or exports, etc., that are going to happen, that's where the mark-to-market adjustments in respect of those items will not be considered in the profit and loss account for tax purposes effectively. Yeah? So those gains or losses would not be allowed as a deduction in computing the income where the items are not forming part of the balance sheet on the last day.
So, Dr. Basu, of what consequence will that be?
There will be consequence in terms of, suppose there is a certainty, and if I see a trend that certain loss are going to occur, people who have booked somewhere, say, in 45, it is not never going to go to 45, it's going to be between 50 to 53. So if I can reduce the tax burden of this quarter,
right,
I should be allowed to reduce that tax burden.
But this tax does not allow you to do
this. This tax will not be allowing me to do so ultimately till such time I end up with the actual settlement of the issue.
Okay.
To add to what Vishal said in terms of not dealing with certain items which is not there in the standard today is related to share-based payment.
Right.
In the case, in the question of share-based payment, again, the provision has allowed me to only book the liability, book the asset not to the extent of the fair valuation of the asset. It will allow me only to book the fair valuation of the asset, which is exchange and whichever is lower.
Right.
In that situation, I will also be deprived of a proper depreciation allowance.
Okay.
And the asset will not be representing its true fair value. The question which will come in, Menaka, that how the things will be seen by the ultimate critics of the balance sheet, that is the analysts.
Analyst community, right. Analyst. Yeah.
You know, Menaka,
you want to respond to this?
I think if without being a defender of the committee.
That's
because,
what you
know,
are. There's no escaping that.
I'm actually talking, you know, personal capacity here, but I think the you touched upon a very important point on the exchange loss on derivatives. I think the way I look at this, one, as you rightly said, there's nothing in the Income Tax Act which deals with it, and therefore you have to fall back on what is there in the accounting standards. The accounting standards are meant for the purpose of giving a prudent view to the investors and readers of the financial statements, and they need to know if there is a probable loss of the nature that you described, that look, you are going to be impacted. Tax is, in my mind, not based on the same principle, because there has to be parity between losses and gains. And therefore, in the same instance, if a company is to claim a deduction for unrealized losses, then logically they should pay taxes on unrealized gain. And Menaka, the impact of that could be very significant, because if you are in a good position, and I know some of my clients who had hundreds of millions of dollars of mark-to-market gains, imagine paying taxes on that unrealized gain.
You leave alone this particular point, but if you see the underlying theme of a right across your 14 standards which you have brought in, there the situation is that most of the cases it is preponement of all the incomes and postponement of
all the expenses,
particularly in areas of onerous contract. And you are also saying that even case of a service contract,
right,
in certain cases you will not be able to in a position to estimate. Suppose it's in a case of technology integration, if the final product doesn't come out, the service provider has to go back to his zero starting point and to start working. But you are asking him to provide right from the day one, 25% is provided. So I think there is an issue which we need to understand, that
sure,
certain established principle of accounting since World War II are being not considered in this tax.
I must add to Jamil's point on this. I think it's a very rational view that the committee is wanting to take in the direction to say that if the gains are not taxed, you don't get the deduction for the losses. You know,
right.
And I think there's a very rational approach, because some time back the CBDT had come up with an internal instruction on this issue,
right,
to say that any mark-to-market adjustments on even on items that are existing on your balance sheet, like debtors, receivables, as I mentioned earlier, would be disallowed for tax computations. Now, those were only internal instructions. Yes. They don't sort of have a binding effect on taxpayers,
right,
in computing their income.
But this formalizes that instruction.
If this gets legislated the way it is supposed,
you've come around to seeing it from Jamil's point of view.
But Menaka, point here is that another issue you brought in, which Vishal, you look at.
Yeah.
You are allowed to do anticipated asset booking,
yes,
which was never done, and reasonable certainty.
Right.
Though reasonable certainty, the people who are in the gaining position to show their organization's profitability, there will be controversy coming in. What is anticipated and reasonable certainty?
Yeah, yeah.
Which was never a situation in accounting world so far.
The position is this, Dr. Basu. The choices, the way I see it, is today we make a provision for litigation. Let's say there is a litigation against a company, and you believe that in good faith that look, you will have to pay something, and you make a provision. In the past, as Vishal said, you know, there was uncertainty whether this provision, which is recorded rightfully in the book, should actually be allowed as a deduction. And there were many tax officers who used to disallow that, and there was a lot of confusion. What we feel is that the moment you have that in the tax accounting standard, that if these conditions are met, you make a provision, it will put an end to those kind of disputes, because that is a legitimate item that is a deductible. The question then comes up is that, again, if you give a deduction for a provision item on the debit side, on the loss side, similarly, if you filed a claim against somebody, which you are going to receive, it can't be. Imagine two parties. One party cannot claim a deduction, and the other party basically said that I'm not going to offer that for taxation. So
right.
I think, look, we we may disagree with how this will be implemented. Yes, but the other option to this was to say, okay, similar to what we talked about on derivative, you will not get a deduction for any liability until you have to actually pay that liability, right?
Okay.
And I thought that would be a very, very extreme measure, and therefore it was better to kind of, you know, deal with, not change that position and bring in, you know, a position to say that anticipated gains kind of could be.
It may be so situation that from an accounting perspective, because you follow prudence, which is your basis of accounting as an accounting as policy, you may not necessarily accrue because that test will not get satisfied.
Definitely.
Now you will have an
accounting
given a total go by.
Is it given a go by? Yeah. And now, from a tax perspective, you will tax it, say, in a particular year when you identify that the guidelines laid down by the report or the guidelines that are sort of said satisfies, and therefore you accrue that as an income today.
That's right.
You know, and then sort of looking at it to say that we don't need to maintain separate sets of accounts, which is what the core recommendation from the committee is also, because that will, of course, increase all of compliance and costs for corporates. It does lead to a situation where you have too many items sort of outside of your balance sheet or your P&L, which then needs adjustments from a tax perspective.
Vishal, I would like to I would like to touch upon the point on reconciliation, because that's an important angle. I think, like I said, the approach that the way I see this is, for most companies, 80-90% of what they do should be in line with what is there in the books of accounts,
right.
And then there will be 5 or 6 items. Even today, as we know, you know, when we prepare our tax return, and let's say depreciation, right? We adjust our depreciation per books, and we claim depreciation as per Section 32 of the Income Tax Act. The committee has recommended that we add, you know, other items to that, and I agree with you that the risk is that this becomes a very cumbersome exercise in terms of doing it. As one very, very knowledgeable professional mentioned to me recently, who I will not name, he basically said, look, as long as you deal with issues around disclosure, we don't have a problem with TAS. As long as you deal with issues on measurement, which are period end adjustments, we don't have a problem. The moment you touch recognition, which
Absolutely.
Is how you deal with underlying transaction, that could create a very big void between what you do for books and what you do for tax, and that is something that should be avoided.
I think we briefly touched upon service revenues, and Vishal, if you'd like to explain to our viewers exactly where you see the deviation and hence what the impact will be.
You know, insofar as the services sector, I think currently most of the service providers, where the contracts or the engagements that the service entity gets into are for a limited period of 1 or 2 months, not the long 2-year or 3-year contracts, but where they are 2 or 3 month contracts, and typically that applies to both Jamil and to me in terms of our organizations which does sort of engagements. You have a milestone-based invoicing,
right.
And therefore, depending on the milestones achieved at the year end, you will accrue those invoices in your books, and you will accordingly offer
that
them to tax.
That seems to now change under the TAS to a percentage of completion.
And it says that you go to percentage of completion, and therefore, what that will entail is that for each of those engagements, I need to identify the cost that I have incurred until 31st of March, which typically is the last date. And therefore, you know, if I have sort of, if say personally, I am working on 20 engagements, I'll have to, in the last 15-20 days, which I have not invoiced my clients for,
right.
I'll have to allocate each of these costs towards each of these engagements and say that that will be forming part of my, the service revenue or the accrued revenue, though I have not billed it to the customer. The second point related to that is that, you might have a situation that you might not be making profit on that. But the way I think the AS2 on valuation of inventories insofar as services contract is concerned, that you only value them at cost and not at cost or the realizable value, which is the basic phenomenon. Because if the realizable value or my billing that's going to happen probably on 15th April or 30th April is not what the cost that I've incurred, I shouldn't be paying income on that logically,
right.
Because that's not what I'm going to get. But the value in AS2 says the TAS on relating to inventories says that you value it at cost, which may that I might have income sitting out there, which may I not be able to recover it ultimately from my client.
Okay, so material impact on profitability?
There will be certain issues in the context of lease accounting also. There will be certain issues in the context of certain contracts where there will be controversy that you have said that 25% the moment you have completion, you start booking. But the person who is providing the service, he may anticipate that although as per the terms of contract, I have done 25% of the service, and if its contract is not properly framed on the milestone basis, which is a vanilla simple contract, then the controversies will be less. But in the context of service industry, which he is saying, there will be lots of issue coming up in terms of litigation. So
if I can pick on the point that you made on why percentage completion for services, interestingly, percentage completion for services is the only way to account for things under IFRS. Okay? So when you move to IFRS, anyways, you will have to do it. There was some company, then I have a client, okay, personally, which enters into services contracts which last 2 years, right? They are an unlisted company, and therefore, and they decide to recognize revenues only when they complete and deliver that particular, you know, kind of thing. There are construction there. And I, and on the other hand, I equally have companies who are listed kind of companies who never afford to do that because they need to show quarterly profits, right? And I think the point is, for the same transaction, you cannot have taxability at two different points in time.
I want you to go from defense to offense. And I don't mean offense in a way of criticism, but can you raise for me or add to the list of accounting practices or sectors that will be impacted because these tasks deviate knowingly from accounting standards in certain cases?
I think there are a couple of more which I would like people to focus on and comment either way. One is on translation of foreign branches. And I'll take a very practical example. If you are a bank which has foreign branches, today you classify your branches into two parts, certain which you call integral, others which you call non-integral. When you translate the numbers of the integral branch, you take all the exchange difference to your profits. When you translate the results of non-integral branches, you take them to your reserves. I know one public sector bank which has 1,800 crores of this gain which came in last year. Under the current approach, when this goes to reserves, obviously you don't pay taxes on that. The TAS recommends that there, because there is no distinction between an integral branch and a non-integral branch, this should come to income. I think that is going to have a material impact for many organizations. The second is for stockbroking entities and banks who hold stock in trade. The simple issue there is, let's say an organization has a stock which it bought at 100 and today the market price is 90. They claim a deduction for that 10 being stock in trade. They have another stock which they bought at 100 and the market price is 200. They don't offer that for taxation. What the TAS recommends is that you look at it on a portfolio basis, i.e. you compare your 200 with the 290 of value, and because in that case there's no diminution, you don't claim that deduction of 10, i.e. you move away from an individual script by script comparison and to a portfolio approach. That could have a material impact for most organizations.
Jamil, one clarification from you. Are you going to suggest on an underlying substance basis that you got into block of asset concept instead of asset to asset concept?
No, what we are saying, this is only in the context of securities, because of the fact that the deduction for unrealized kind of losses, and if you see the TAS then lists down the six categories, you know, where I don't think that's a generic principle you want to go down, but specifically for the purpose of valuation of stock in trade of securities is, you know,
I understand that, but when a downtrend comes in the market and trading stocks are held, losses will not be allowed to be booked, perhaps there will be an issue because you are not getting into asset by asset item, but you are going into block by block item.
Yes, Dr. Basu. And again, the thinking is simple, that if you're sitting on a portfolio of assets, right, some with a gain and some with a loss, at a personal level as well, I feel it is not correct to claim a deduction for the losses and not pay for the gain. I mean, again, one could have two views on this, but that was the thinking behind the recommendation.
All right, and that makes it clear. I think we're literally at the end of time. We have 1 minute left to go, so I'm going to give 25 seconds to each one of you. Is this what you'd like to see rectified based on all the feedback that comes in as one mid-step towards converging to IFRS? Or do you believe another route would be more practical and viable for industry? And what is that route?
I think the objectives of the report are very noble in terms of achieving consistency, reducing litigation, etc. The question is that is notifying accounting standards separately for tax purpose the only solution? Probably the other solution is to, when you have these deviations which are rightly identified as the areas where you have concerns or you want consistency, why don't you bring them as the part of the law itself?
So legislating part would be done as part of the DTC then, eventually, or in the existing Act itself?
In the Income Tax Act, because in fact when you go to the DTC, the relevance of the accounting standards will be very different, because the DTC goes on an income expense model for computing your income, you know, and that sort of completely deviates from the current scene where the accounting profits.
This will not make any sense if we move to a DTC.
I'm waiting for my 25 seconds.
Okay, Dr. Basu.
I personally feel that unless controversies are set at rest by giving implementation guideline and reducing some of the areas and scope where there can be difference of opinion, and not aligning the tax accounting standards certainly with the law, there would be problems, and from the industry perspective, our people will have to sweat and stretch further to comply with both the accounting standards.
Okay. So we have Ind AS, AS, TAS, DTC. Is this all going to eventually converge at some point, Jamil?
I think it's unlikely, and I think the reason is because...
I missed IFRS in that acronym.
Unlikely, Menka, because I think the objective of fiscal and the objective of reporting is rightfully different, and this is acknowledged across the world as well, i.e. you don't have to be aligned.
All right, gentlemen, I know we barely covered the tip of the iceberg. There's so much more to discuss, but we're entirely at the end of our time. Thank you very much, Vishal, Dr. Basu, and Jamil, most importantly, you, for being able to explain to us what went on in the committee's mind when they came up with these 14 tax accounting standards. With that, thanks very much for watching. Happy Diwali again.